unexpected industries. You know, beverage companies, pharmaceuticals, certainly automotive, aerospace, banking, finance, insurance, retail, on and on. And they're all trying to figure it out, right? And we're just at the beginning of this. And the other thing that I see, which is really fascinating, is, you know, now a computer isn't just the thing you carry around with you or, you know, in your pocket, right? The number of computers is just exploding. And you see this in many forms. If you look at the number of microprocessors that ARM has licensed, I think it's approaching 100 billion cores. Then you throw in Intel and all the others. As I said earlier, the cost of making something intelligent is approaching $0. And that means there's going to be a lot more of them. And then you have this enormous amount of data, not just the real-time data, but the time series data. And then you take all that data and you apply machine intelligence to it, artificial intelligence, deep learning, unsupervised learning. And then you get even better with a whole new set of hardware capabilities that accelerate that, and then you repeat the process. And so it's really an amazing time. You think the last 30 years of IT have been fun, interesting, exciting, compelling, and changed the world. I think the next 30 years will be much, much more so. So thrilled to have you all here. Happy to answer your questions. They have to reimagine their business in the context of all these new technologies. And you know, certainly every company has to take it, you know, step by step, and each industry is going to be a little different in terms of how the digital transformation applies to it. But I don't see any part of the world that is exempt from this. You know, I happen to believe that technology plus humans is more the answer, as opposed to, you know, technology versus the humans. I think it's always been that way. If you think back to the earliest things that you wouldn't even think of as technology, like the wheel, right? it created jobs and new industries and new capabilities, and also destroyed them. All technology in one form or another is like that. And I happen to have an optimistic view of the world that technology will enhance human capability and capacity. Now, it presents some difficult challenges because the technology is changing so fast, and how do we update skills and resources and knowledge to be able to make the best use of that. But if you look today in the world, we don't have as much of the bad science fiction predicted future that people had imagined. And we have a lot of wonderful, great things happening because of technology. So that's more what I see. Yeah, well, look, I remember going to Oculus when they were just getting going, and we just did a little demo backstage, in between this session and the keynote. You know, look, if you think about video, the really interesting thing about video and visualization is you can take in information far faster with your eyes than any other way, right? You can't smell it, you can't feel it, you can't touch it, hear it nearly as fast as you can see it. And actually, the VR and AR that we have today is sort of game-like, right? It's not very high resolution, the frame rate isn't so great. And so as you take those technologies and move them along the spectrum of 2K, 4K, 8K, 24 frames, 48 frames, 60 frames, 2D, 3D, then into 360 VR, you get a kind of photorealistic. It's sort of like teleportation, actually, when you see this in all of its most amazing capability. But we're kind of a long way off from that. And if I take all those enhancements to the technology, the amount of data required is hundreds of times what it is today. And so that means you're in some kind of connected infrastructure. Yeah, we have the fifth generation cellular network coming. That's very interesting and exciting. Creates a whole another set of opportunities for distributed computing. You know, we look at the AR and VR and see enormous potential, not just in entertainment, but also in training and in you know, business applications. My wife and I are involved in something called the Dell Medical School at the University of Texas, and they're using AR and VR to train the next generation of medical students. I think we're just at the beginning of this. It takes time for these things to occur, but the speed of innovation and all the possibilities that are created with technologies like AR and VR is tremendous. So clearly, what Dell Technologies does is far beyond just the PC. The point of what I called out is that the PC is still very important to our customers and to us. Actually, for us, the average selling prices for PCs have been going up, not down. And so too have the revenues for the PC business been going up, not down. And our share in the PC business is going up as well. We've had now 17 quarters in a row of gaining share. And I can tell you, being in the middle of the 18th quarter, yes, it'll be the 18th quarter in a row of gaining share. So we've invested in innovation, in R&D. Clearly there's a market consolidation, and that business gives us incredible scale. So, I also think if you think about the Internet of Things, the parents of the Internet of Things are PCs. And so we're learning a lot about the future of distributed computing from all the work that we've done in the client business. And there's also something just around the corner that is about to occur, and that is this fifth generation cellular network, a low latency, high bandwidth network that will connect hundreds of billions of devices together and create a new kind of distributed computing and distributed cloud. That is going to be rather amazing. That fifth generation cellular network is not so you can talk on the phone faster. It's all about data. And that's going to create enormous amounts of data. Not all of that data will sit in one place. You're going to have an even more distributed computing environment. And so if you look across what we think of today as the client business, which had a tremendous resurgence for us, I think, in the last few years in terms of our share, the business is now different. Along with this workplace transformation, one of the things that customers have figured out is that it really does not make sense to give the people that work in your company or your organization the cheapest, lowest cost computer. If you want to attract and retain and make productive people inside your company, you actually want to give them great tools so you can inspire their creativity and their productivity. And I think that's one of the reasons why the average selling prices for PCs is going up, not down. It's why the innovation and design and features and capabilities in our products are being rewarded. Having said all that, there's a market consolidation, and we're continuing to gain share. So the way we think about it is we have a business that is both direct and partner, right? And it's not direct or partner, it's direct and partner. And today, roughly $35 billion of our roughly $75 billion in revenues are with and through partners. And we don't really think about it as this is going to go up and that's going to go down. We want to grow both. And the partners bring a complementary set of capabilities and access to customers. We have an enormous number of tremendous partners. Along with Dell EMC World, we'll have a partner conference. We'll be meeting with them later today. The partner reaction to the combination of Dell and EMC has been tremendous. and the broader, you know, Dell Technologies creation for a number of these partners is really super. Just like we're seeing with customers that want to do more with fewer companies, we're seeing the same with the partner. So, you know, partner program is a big, important part of our success, and it's not just what you would think of as the traditional partners. It also extends into systems integrators. I mentioned our new expansion of the Pivotal relationship with Cognizant. Also, we have an OEM business, right? Those are part of our partner ecosystem. We have thousands of customers that use our technology embedded in their solutions.
In moving from the traditional selling products to selling solutions, if you want.
Yeah, we're on a path to evolve our business, and our customers are evolving too. So when I talked earlier about the role of IT changing, that is very much a fellow traveler, right, in terms of our own ability to change. So the digital transformation kind of being the epicenter of this, how do you extend the conversation beyond the field of IT and into actually the business itself? And when you think about digital transformation, it's not an IT project, it's a CEO project, it's right at the center of the evolution of the company. So we're changing, we're evolving our capabilities and skills. Customers are pulling on us more for these solutions. And first of all, you have to be able to have them, right? You can't just talk about it. You gotta be relevant and bring, you know, tremendous value. I think we're making good progress. Remember, the combination was completed over 8 months ago. So we're pretty far along onto this, and we've had again, great reaction from customers of all sizes, and I think off to a great start. So again, thank you all for being here. Now back.